Tommy, you wrote back in September that President Trump had made it unmistakably clear that there were only two choices before voters on November 3rd, and electing Joe Biden was not one of them. It was either the president is elected or there's fraud or it's rigged. Now that we're watching this play out in real time, what are your thoughts? I mean, one defense official at the Pentagon told Barbara Starr that these are dictator moves.
Well, great question, Anderson. You know, my first reaction is profound sadness for this reason. Anderson, we just had the most amazing election in the middle of a pandemic that is getting worse by the day. More Americans got up, found a way to vote by mail, in person, 150 million of them, basically, in a free and fair election. This is the most, and by the way, and their friends and neighbors, because this is how we do it in this country, went out and counted those ballots freely and fairly without any major issue of fraud. That's what actually happened. It was the most amazing expression of a people's commitment to democracy since the election of 1864, when we had an election in the middle of a civil war and Lincoln defeated McClellan. We should be celebrating this. Our president should be celebrating this. If John McCain had been there, George H.W. Bush, George W. Bush, Bill Clinton, any other president and rival would have looked at this and said, what an amazing day for American democracy. And what did we get instead? We have a president who is only concerned about himself, who puts himself before country, and is only concerned by the fact that he lost narrowly, and therefore is trying to soil what is actually the greatest expression of our democracy since our election in 1864. And that is profoundly sad, and it is so disturbing to see so many members of his party joining in his amen chorus.
You know, it was also an election that was actually very good for Republicans. I mean, this, you know, other than Joe Biden winning, you know, none of the, you know, the scenarios that the Democrats certainly were, you know, hoping for and talking about of you know, massive, a massive victory of taking over the Senate, all of that, that didn't happen.
It was really an expression of the center-left, center-right core of the country, really expressing its will to be governed through some compromise, you know. And that's what makes the whole thing, it's just so disturbing, because we can only go forward and do big, hard things if we do them together. And the country was basically screaming that, and we are soiling it. But you know what else strikes me, Anderson? You know, the day after the vote, or when President-elect Biden was confirmed, church bells rang all over Europe. Wow, people just went out in the streets. Why were they so happy? It's because they knew better, I think, than some Americans what was at stake. Because they've watched what's been going on in Europe, in Hungary, in Poland, in Russia, Belarus. What have they, Turkey, what have they seen? They've seen these right-wing nationalists take power through free and fair elections, and then use the power of the state to ensconce themselves in power, pervert their court system, and basically try to maintain minority rule. They see it going on everywhere. And they looked across the ocean, and they were worried. They were so worried that it was going to happen in America. And it didn't happen. The American people didn't let it happen. And they went out and they rang church bells and they hollered and they danced in the streets. They don't do that when France has an election. They don't do that when the UK has an election. But they did it because it happened in America. Because we started the whole thing in 1800 when Jefferson defeated John Adams and Jefferson went home. We started that trend, that moment. The loser goes home. And right now, that thing we started that gave birth to democracy all over the world, that is now in peril because of this president and the lackeys in his party who put themselves before country.
Yeah, I mean, it is the lackeys in his party, as you said, that is particularly, I guess, surprising. You know, there had been talk, even you heard from some, never Trumper Republicans who, you know, talked about a reckoning that might take place or should take place in the Republican Party after Trump leaves. It seems pretty clear there's not going to be any kind of reckoning because President Trump really isn't going anywhere, even when he ultimately leaves office, which is what is going to happen. He's going to be ensconced in Mar-a-Lago with a very big microphone and probably a TV camera and the power to raise funds or not raise funds for Republican candidates. And he very, you know, there's, you know, he's talking about coming back. It is stunning to me the extent to which not only has he remade the Republican Party while he's in office, it seems like he's holding on to it even when he's gone.
Yeah, although when he's actually gone, we'll see, you know, because Bonnie's always there. These guys, it always seems like they'll never go and they'll always have power. After he's gone, that party could also turn into scorpions in a bottle as they all go after each other, especially to succeed him. I don't know, you know, exactly what will happen. All I know is this, Anderson, you and I have talked about it before. We will not have a healthy democracy unless we have a healthy liberal party and a healthy conservative party. And right now we have a deeply disturbed conservative party. We have a conservative party that basically has been selling itself to the highest bidder of whoever can energize its base, Sarah Palin, the Tea Party, Donald Trump. And if you can energize the base so they can continue to hold on to power by any means possible, you're their guy. And until that party goes through an internal reckoning, which you hope once Trump's defeat sinks in still might happen, our country will not be right, and we will not be able to govern in the effective way that we need to. Anderson, you may have noticed, there's two countries out there who so conspicuously have not congratulated Biden. They're called Russia and China. And you know why? Because Xi and Putin are sitting in front of the TV. I bet they've got their feet up on the sofa. They've popped popcorn, put a little butter on, and they are so enjoying watching America in turmoil, because it means America can never organize a global coalition against them, like for China today, which just arrested a whole bunch of democracy advocates in Hong Kong, and never against Putin's Russia. Oh my God, they are so enjoying the show. Thank you very much, Mike Pompeo.
Yeah, I mean, and you talk about profiles of courage. I mean, Mike Pompeo, or, you know, and I say that sarcastically, Mike Pompeo and a lot of Republican senators, it's so clear they're thinking. I mean, clearly they're looking at the race in Georgia, and, you know, they don't want to upset Trump and his supporters. And they're afraid, you know, they feel like they have to coddle the president because they're afraid he will take it out on the two Republican candidates in Georgia, which he is entirely capable of doing.
Oh, absolutely. We saw what he's, again, done to his own Secretary of Defense. You know, I keep getting in trouble with the left and the right, because, look, I wish we had a balanced government where everyone had some skin in the game, but only if they're ready to play the game, okay? And Mitch McConnell, last time he was in that situation with Barack Obama, did everything he could to undermine Obama's presidency, make it a failure, in hopes that if it failed, people would blame Obama. And, you know, we don't have time for that anymore, folks. I'd much rather trust Joe Biden and his moderate instincts and the message of the American people to get us at least through 2 years of dealing with climate, dealing with the fact that 60% of our population has not had a raise in real income since 1980, dealing with infrastructure, dealing with these big challenges, because we can't go 4 more years, Anderson, with gridlock. Otherwise, we are going to be so much in China's rearview mirror. And if you think this election was disturbed, wait till the next one. And that's what's troubling. Anderson, how do you feel about the next election? It really is worrisome. If these people will do this when they lose, what would happen if they win?
And Joe Biden, the task that his administration faces, you know, it's not just Republicans who maybe they will have a reckoning and decide gridlock is not the answer. But even just the left wing of his own party, there's going to be a real issue. I mean, there were a lot of folks who got people to vote, signed up, a lot of registered, you know, a lot of Black Lives Matter people in the Black Lives Matter movement worked very hard to register voters, get new voters in, turn people out in Detroit and other cities. And yet, you know, Joe Biden's already talking about, you know, ruling from the center.
Well, you know, Anderson, I go back always to where it all started, and that's South Carolina. Boy, I wish I could travel now, go to a church in South Carolina, maybe go up to the choir, sit with the ladies in the choir, and Black ladies, and ask them, why did you lift Joe Biden off the mat? His candidacy was basically dead before he showed up here in South Carolina. And you and Jim Clyburn, you guys lifted him off the mat. The referee was counting him out. 1, 2, 3, you stopped his hand. Why did you do that? Was it because you want a Medicare for all? Was it because you want an African-American president? You could have voted for Cory Booker. Why did you do that? I think it was because they had the wisdom to understand that the country's being torn apart. And what we needed was someone like Biden to pull it back together again. And everybody's going to have to compromise. That's why they did it. And their intuition was right. We are so indebted to those people. And I say to everyone on the left, the far left, the center left, the right, the far right, and you know the center right, give the guy a chance. Give the guy a chance before you start making broad claims about what he owes you. The only people he owes are the folks down in that church in South Carolina. They're the ones who had the wisdom to turn this whole thing around.